I'm a medical oncologist across the road, and I'll be talking to you about cancer genetics, the basics. But before that, I thought I'll just go a little bit through the history, which I'd studied in. I'd studied in school, I'd almost forgotten, so just a refresher for me as well as for you. So a lot of excitement about genetics. More and more people think that lots of diseases which we have right now, although it is partly due to lifestyle factors, there is underlying genetic problem which creates a susceptibility to that particular disease. So you can see lots of headlines from Time magazine, Science magazine, all related to the genetics and genome. So my outline will be, I'll just give you a brief history of how genetics, the knowledge about genetics evolved. I'll talk about genes and the mutations, and the main topic, cancer genetics, the clinical significance, and a little bit about hereditary cancer. So initially the molecular biology genetics started with the study of cells, and as you know, Robert Hooke was the first one to describe that organisms are actually made of various cells, and a couple of German scientists who further expanded the study. The boss, the father of genetics, is Gregor Mendel. He was a Christian priest. I think he had a lot of spare time on his hands, so he started finding out, breeding peas actually, garden peas, to find out how the genetic traits are transmitted down. Most people would have wondered, much before Gregor Mendel did, why the children look like them or sometimes don't look like them. So he is the first one to scientifically study that. And he found, at that time he didn't know about genes, but he found out that the traits were passed in two forms, dominant and recessive. And he basically studied the garden pea, so I'll just skip to that. So he studied the purple flower and the white flower of the garden pea, and he crossbred them. So he crossbred the purple and the white, and he found the next generation, which is called the F1 generation, is all purple. The white had vanished, but when he inbred them, he found that the white popped out again. So that is very interesting, which means that the trait of white is somewhere hidden in the purple, and when they were inbred, the white came out. So for our purposes, we call the purple color the dominant trait, and very important for genetics, for cancer genetics, because we call this dominant trait the oncogene. I'll come to that little later. And the recessive one is sometimes called tumor suppressor genes. We'll discuss that a little later. So essentially, there's a dominant and a recessive trait. And he found that in multiple other, not only flower, the position of the flower, the color of the seed, the shape of the seed, he found they can be either dominant or they can be recessive. And he called them units, but now we call them genes. Carrying on with the history, they found the nucleus contained chromosomes, which is composed of nucleic acids. They identified the structures of the 20 essential amino acids. Fisher found that these amino acids joined together form the proteins, which are the basics of life. And more importantly, Thomas Morgan found that the genes are on the chromosomes, which is, seems simple to us now, but at that time they didn't know. Chromosomes are in the nucleus and the genes are in the chromosomes. He did work on fruit flies. The next step was in 1941 when they discovered that these genes make the proteins, which are made of amino acids, as I told you earlier. And Charga found that there are basically four types of bases: adenine, thymine, guanine, and cytosine. And the cytosine goes with guanine and adenine goes with thymine. So CG and AT. This is in DNA. In the RNA, there is no thymine. What is there? Instead of thymine, there is another base, uracil. Perfect. Yeah, it's a U. Don't mind if I ask questions in between. Just make sure you keep awake and don't text also. So the next major, which we all know about, is that Watson and Crick found that this DNA is organized in a double helix form, which is their model which they made. But a lot of people don't know is that Rosalind Franklin, Rosalind. She was an X-ray crystallographer who worked with them, and she's actually the one who discovered this structure by crystallography, but her work was ignored. So lesson for you, when you find a new syndrome, make sure your work is not ingrained, okay? Make sure you get due credit for it. So this has been made into a movie as well as it's a play currently going on in London. Nicole Kidman is the person, so she plays Rosalind Franklin, and how her claims, how her work has been ignored. Right, carrying on with the history, somebody found out a mechanism for sequencing the genes. So they went on to announce that the complete human genome will be analyzed. That's the Human Genome Project, and it was announced in 1990 by the US Congress. And Craig Venter is a private guy. He first did the bacterial genome, then he went ahead and did his own genome later. And that is when the human genome was finally published in the Science magazine in 2001. So we know the complete human genome now. And then there have been a couple of more advances after that. So basically, essentially, we are made out of genes. And the complete genetic knowledge, we call it the genome. Coming to the basics of genetics. So this picture is familiar to all of you. There are chromosomes. There are 23 pairs, 22 autosomal and 2 sex chromosomes. So this is what it looks like in metaphase, when they are frozen and photographed and separated out. But when you look, and each of that part, each part of that codes for a particular gene. There are a lot of DNA in between. It doesn't code for anything. Previously it used to be called junk DNA, but now we know that they code for type of RNA, but that RNA is not translated into protein. So the RNA is, there are various types of RNA, basically called microRNA, interferon, miRNAs. But the genes are the parts of the chromosome which codes for a particular protein. So what does it look like if you take a picture of and keep magnifying it? This is what the chromosome which we saw in metaphase. And then this is the multiple, it's all packed in very tightly on a scaffold. And when you magnify it further, you find this, the blue line is the DNA, which is packed around certain proteins called nucleosomes. And that makes the structure of the chromosome. The reason for this is to make sure a lot of information is packed very tightly into a nucleus, into a small cell. So finally, when you unravel it, this is what the DNA looks like. And what the DNA does is it transcribes to RNA, and RNA translate into a protein. This is the central dogma of current genetics. So again, total basics. There's a sugar phosphate backbone. There are 4 types of bases: adenine, thymine, cytosine, guanine. And 3 of them put together is called a codon, will code for a for an amino acid. And when you put all the amino acid together, it forms a protein. So a codon is made of 3 base pairs. The first one is AUG always, it is methionine, and it starts the translation, it starts the protein formation. There are 61 other codons which code for 20 amino acids. And there is a UAA, which is a stop codon. This is on the, obviously, you're talking about U, that means it's about the RNA. We are talking about the RNA, not the DNA now. So coming back to the DNA, so it's basically what I've said again, the 3 base pairs G, C and A forms alanine. The A, G and A forms arginine. So these bases are coding for amino acids, which are linked together to form the protein, and then they fold together to form further proteins. This is the RNA part of it. So you have, if you take the first position is uracil, the second position is the cytosine, and the third position is guanine, then you get this amino acid of serine. Similarly, if the first one is uracil, second one is adenine, and the third one is uracil or cytosine, then you get tyrosine. And so on and so forth, you can code for all the 20 amino acids. Some numbers. In the human, there are 46 chromosomes, 6 billion base pairs. We know they code for about less than 30,000 genes. It's written 20 to 23,000 proteins, or equivalent to genes, but it's about less than 30,000 genes, and that's not really different from the mouse or the gorilla. Just the way they are translated makes a difference. I can skip that. Coming to our part of the talk, the cancer genetics, now that we know a little bit about the basics. Firstly, cancer is a disease of genes. It does not mean it's a genetic disease. Not doesn't mean that cancer is inherited always. Some of them are. But basically, cancer occurs because there is some abnormality in the genes. When genes are abnormal, they are called mutated genes, right? So this is the central part. the cancer, all cancers are due to abnormalities in the genes. So this is the outline of the talk after this. It will be cancer genes, the cause of mutation, types of mutation and the clinical implications. What causes the mutations? Mostly it is lifestyle. We like to think it is, you know, pollution and things like that, but basically it's things like smoking, red meat which we eat that causes colon cancer. About 5 to 10% are due to infections, hepatitis, helicobacter. There are a lot of other bacteria and all which can cause cancers. Radiation, of course, there's a background radiation by a gas called radon which can cause. There are some carcinogens in diet. Aflatoxin is one which is from a fungus, but there are also carcinogens which are formed by the way you cook. There are a lot of, especially when you grill and fry, a lot of carcinogens are formed. They are one of the major causes of colon cancers. Lastly, our interest, inherited. Inherited cancers are just about 5 to 10% of all cancers, mostly due to lifestyle. Pollution forms very, very small percentage. Because a lot of, we don't know what causes cancer in a lot of cases. Bad luck is one of the things which people think happen, but bad luck just means we don't know what the cause is. I'm sure there will be causes discovered later. This is essential to know. There are two types of mutations broadly called germline and somatic. This is important to know because when you are testing patients for mutations, if it is germline, it is usually inherited. And so because inherited is there in all cells of the body. The tumor may happen in one organ, particular organ, but this particular mutation will be there in all cells of the body. And obviously it can pass on to the next generation also. Your children are susceptible. Because it's present in all cells, you can test in any tissue. You can do it in lymphocytes, or you can do it in your saliva, cells in the saliva. You can. While somatic mutations are acquired, and it's only in the tumor cells. If you want to test, you have to test the tumor. You cannot test WBCs. It cannot pass on, and you have to test the actual tumor to see the mutation. So this should be clear. There's a germline mutation and there's a somatic mutation. Right, so what happens, what are these mutations? Here we'll talk about something called a point mutation. I already told you that the base pairs form the functional protein, but rarely this is a point mutation. That means one base is knocked out, it could form a non-functional or a missing protein, right? There are plenty of types of damages which can happen to DNA. Knocking out one base pair is called a point mutation, but there are other mutations where the whole entire gene can be deleted, entire part of the chromosome can be deleted. It can be amplified, it can be inverted, it can, you know, get cut out and stuck in the other way around. All of them leads to abnormal proteins and can lead to cancer, but we are talking mainly about point mutations. So what can happen is, this is again the base pairs. If adenine is, this is the normal sequence, but sometimes when it is mutated, the A is replaced by a T, it may not have any effect. Maybe a silent mutation may not cause any problem at all because it is compensated by other genes. But it is some other mutations there can lead to disease because the protein is either less produced less or it's non-functioning. So essentially, you can, mutated protein can have no effect. It can be overactive, it can be amplified, or it can be underactive because it's totally deleted. In oncology cancer terms, the overactive ones we call oncogenes. These are the dominant genes, and because they are overactive, they can drive the cancer cell into proliferation and eventually into cancer. Underactive, there are two types of genes, tumor suppressor genes. These are genes which basically put a brake on cancer division. They are present in normal people, they help you, they prevent cancers. But if they are not active, that means cancers can form. The brake is lost. So this is an accelerator, it speeds up the cell proliferation. This normally functions as a brake, but if the brake is lost, you can imagine what happens. There's also a more lesser known group called DNA repair genes. Their job, as the name says, is to repair defects and genes multiply. Obviously, if they are lost, you can again get a cancer. I'm sorry?
Tumor suppressor gene also, it is responsible for apoptosis.
Yes, you're absolutely right. Some of the tumor suppressor genes like BCL2, their normal job is to make sure the damaged cancer cell undergoes apoptosis. So and if they are missing, obviously the cancer cells will keep on multiplying.
And this one, it will lead to hereditary cancer syndrome.
Yes, you're right. Good. So essentially, the genes in the normal cells, when they are mutated, they form a cancer. So this is again the summary of what type of genes, the oncogenes, tumor suppressor genes and DNA repair genes. So oncogenes, these are normal genes that control, regulate cell growth. And if they are dominant, so if one of them is mutated, it leads to accelerated cell division and to cancer development. So these are oncogenes. And they are basically, they are mutated, it's got autosomal dominant inheritance. I will not go into that. While the tumor suppressor genes, they are usually recessive in the sense that the first mutation, it just makes the person susceptible to cancer. It actually doesn't cause cancer. It requires a second mutation for them to lead to cancer. So two mutations are required. So this led to a person called Alfred Knudsen to call it a two-hit hypothesis. So the first hit hypothesis, first hit is there, patient does not develop cancer. So this is, let's see, these are the parents. One of them has a hit, but doesn't have cancer. But when it inherited into the our patient, so the first hit is carried on, and when the second hit is also there, both the genes are knocked out, the patient gets cancer. And this is clearly seen in a condition called retinoblastoma. If you ever see a child with a reflex like that, with a pupil like that, be very careful. It's the earliest indication of retinoblastoma. So here basically the child has inherited a mutant retinoblastoma gene, and if the second mutation, he can develop retinoblastoma. However, single mutated gene is not enough. One gene mutation does not produce cancer straight away. Cancer actually evolves through multiple mutations. And that is what this diagram shows. Normal cell, the first mutation, nothing happens. Second mutation, nothing happens. Third mutation, later on it develops into a cancer cell. How many mutations? The minimum required is around, expected about 6 to 8 mutations are required per cancer cell, per cell to make it into a cancer cell. The reason is, it is just not enough for oncogene to increase the proliferation, because the body has got lots of mechanisms to prevent such abnormal cells, to clean them out, to kill them by immunity and other things. So it's not only proliferation, it has to evade the suppressor. Tumor suppressor genes are there, it will prevent it. It has to evade that, so the tumor suppressor gene has to get mutated. Then it needs further gene mutation so that it can invade into normal tissue and spread to other parts of the body. There is a limit called a Hayflick limit. Thus, no cells can divide more than, they say, up to 50 times. So to have immortality, that means to replicate indefinitely, you need mutations in the gene called, codes for something called telomerase. Other genes are also there. It also needs blood supply to grow. So it needs mutations in the genes which cause angiogenesis, formation of new blood vessels. And of course, as you have correctly said, it requires to avoid apoptosis also. So the BCL2 gene, other genes involved with apoptosis has to be mutated. So one mutation cannot cause cancer. It requires about 6 to 8 minimum. But as you will see, there are cancers that can have hundreds of mutations. So there is a big project going on called the Cancer Genome Atlas. They are based, I think, in USA. And they have tested all these multiple tumors for somatic mutations, and as you can see, they up to the ones which are maximally mutated are cancers like melanoma, lung cancer, stomach, and so on and so forth. They can have up to thousands of mutations, which is a problem for us, because sometimes we treat patients based on the mutations they have, and when you have 1,000 mutations, or Nishad does 400 panel and tells us, okay, these genes are mutated, then we are difficult to find out which is the gene to target. These mutations are held in a repository called the COSMIC, or the Catalog of Somatic Mutations Cancer. This is, I think, in UK in Sanger Institute. When last checked, it was around 2,000 cancer genes have been put in the library. Of these, 138 are called driver genes. This is a peculiar situation where patient may have 1,000 odd mutations, but it's one gene which is driving the cancer cells to grow. It's called oncogene addiction. The cancer is addicted to that particular gene. And so if we can block this particular gene, the rest of the cancer can vanish. And I'll show you examples of that. So it's important to know this driver gene concept. The driver genes can be either oncogenes or tumor suppressor genes. So I told you multiple mutations occur for cancers to develop. This is an example by one person called Bert Vogelstein came out with this model, that how a normal colon can develop into cancer colon. So the first mutation which happens, generally speaking, is in a gene called APC. And that makes it an adenoma. It's just a growth, tumor cells, nothing, it is not cancer. Next, another mutation occurs in a gene called KRAS, further followed by a gene mutation in a gene called TP53 or what we call P53, and that converts this particular adenoma or polyp into cancer, and further mutations cause the cancer cells to spread out and metastasize. The importance of this is for this APC to mutate sequentially and form a cancer takes at least 20 to 40 years. So this gives us a lot of time to catch the cancer early. Even before the cancer occurs, we can predict, okay, this person is susceptible to cancer, we can put him under surveillance or we can intervene, which I'll tell you about a little later. So that's the importance of knowing this, that cancer evolves. This is exactly the same thing in a different diagram. Other than the APC gene, there's also genes involved in DNA repair which can mutate. That's also a cause of cancers. And again, the significance of that is, there is one is MSI and one is APC. The significance of that is the patient already comes with the germline, he has inherited it, this mutation, then they develop cancers at a very early age. They don't, in 60, they can produce cancers at 20s and 30s. Because of this germline mutation, other parts of the body, other cells, they can have other tumors also, a higher risk of other cancers. And of course, we can screen for these particular mutations. Okay, coming to the clinical implications, there are a lot of clinical implications in knowing a particular gene mutation. And that's why we are very happy that you people have put up this genetic center and studying these mutations. We can use the knowledge of mutation to screen not only the patient for future other cancers, but the patient's family. We can detect, we can diagnose, we can classify, we can tell the prognosis, and now more and more we can use it for treatment and prevention. So I'll take up the first, start with the detection first. Colon cancer is pretty common in Oman. Normally, there's no screening policy here. Normally, we check for fecal occult blood or something called a fecal immunochemical test. It's immunology. But now, we can test the stool for the DNA, for mutated DNA. This particular test is called Cologuard. And they basically check for DNA methylation, RAS. I already told you about RAS. And this is a housekeeping gene. So they have a sort of algorithm and they form a score. And using this, they tested multiple people, and this was published in NEJM last year. The Cologuard outperformed the normal immunochemical test by a significant percentage. That is, I mean, the actual name is multi-target DNA test, but it is apparently much more effective than the standard test which we are doing now. A lot of people don't like to go for colonoscopy surveillance because of for colon cancer surveillance because of colonoscopy. It is quite a uncomfortable procedure. So a test like this, using DNA mutations, can tell us whether the patient has a colon cancer or not. The other use of knowing is to diagnose particularly. I'm just giving an example of Burkitt lymphoma. Incidentally, I was reading a magazine outside, I'm told that this is wrong. There is no apostrophe S, you just write Burkitt lymphoma. Okay, it's because Burkitt has not patented it nor did he suffer from it. So it's Burkitt lymphoma. And this is caused by a gene called c-myc, which translocates and sticks to another gene called IGH, and the c-mycs become overactive and that drives the tumor. So we can look for this amplified c-myc by two methods, by immunohistochemistry or by FISH, that is fluorescent in situ hybridization. So this shows a strong positivity for myc, and this is the multiple. They use two probes, so if one green for IGH and one red for c-myc, and if they come together, that means they are translocated and lying close together. As you can see, this green and red are very close together, so they're lying close together, that means there's a translocation. We do that a lot. Dr. Nasser, who is our immunohematologist, sometimes we find tumors which are, he reports as diffuse large cell, and we find they're aggressive, maybe it is Burkitt, so he sends it for a c-myc FISH, and that will tell us whether the c-myc is amplified and translocated, and that makes it into a Burkitt, because it makes a difference in the treatment. Burkitt we treat very aggressively. What happens is when c-myc is translated to IGH, the immunoglobulin H heavy chain gene, that becomes overactive, so it produces lots of protein. The protein is expressed on the cell surface. Dark brown. Yeah, the brownish ones. Yes. So that is stained for by a special stain. Immunohistochemistry is, they all look brown actually, because that's what the chromogen is brown.
Of course, we need a normal slide to compare, is that right?
Yeah, we don't have a normal slide to compare. This is totally abnormal, strongly positive. Yeah, and that's the FISH. There is a new technology called DNA microarray. For immunohistochemistry, you have to test for one gene every time. So that is, takes a long time. If you are going to test for 1,000 genes, it will take a very long time. So there's a test called a DNA microarray, which I don't think we have here. It comes, it is as small as this, and you can, it doesn't really test for a gene, it tests for DNA fragments. The DNA fragments are already on the chip, and then you put your sample on it, it goes and hybridizes, and then you can see by bioinformatics, which Dr. Nishad is expert, it'll look something like this. If a gene is amplified, it'll come as red. And if it is under deleted or absent or underperforming, it comes as green. So here there are multiple samples coated like this, and maybe more than 1,000 samples, and these are the genes checked for in this particular. This is like, for instance, this is a c-myc gene which is tested in the first sample, and as you can see, in this first, these four places, it is underexpressed, but here it is overexpressed. It is red. So depending on how it's the green and the red signals, you can classify them into. In this case, in diffuse large B-cell lymphoma, we classify into two major groups, activated B-cell type and germinal cell type. And this is important because you cannot make out this differentiation by normal immuno. Firstly, of course, we can test multiple genes in one shot like this. And secondly, with this DNA microarray. And secondly, this differentiation we cannot do by normal testing, by immunohistochemistry or any other test. Only this gene expression profile can tell us. And that's important because we can tell out, we can differentiate the prognosis. The germinal B cell has got a much better prognosis than the activated B cell type. And there is some treatment differences also which not come to clinic yet, but in future I'm sure it will come. So it can classify tumors into smaller subgroups based on this gene expression profiling. So again, genes are important. Cancer treatment is now more and more based on gene mutations. So previously it was chemotherapy. We used to give chemotherapy to everybody. It didn't make a difference what mutations, what genes. Everybody used to get it, and that had a lot of side effects. So now we are focusing more on targeted therapy. This is the previous classification of lung cancer. We used to go by histology as squamous, adenocarcinoma, small cell, others, and large cell. This used to be the previous classification. But now we don't go by that. We go by molecular classification. And in 37%, we cannot really find a proper dominant mutation. But these are normal genes which are mutated in this adenocarcinomas. So KRAS in 25%, epithelial growth factor receptor in 15%. These are sensitizing useful mutations, and so on and so forth. So now we have a molecular classification of cancer. And this is important because most of these have a specific drug which we can target. So instead of using chemotherapy, which kills all dividing cells, we can target these. So if you just look at these targets, suppose you take EGFR, the sensitizing mutation, we have drugs called erlotinib, gefitinib, afatinib, which can specifically target these mutations. If it is ALK positive, we have drugs called crizotinib and seritinib, which targets that. If this BRAF mutated, we have drugs called vemurafenib, HER2, we have drugs called trastuzumab or Herceptin. So now we are moving away from one drug for everybody to specific mutation. You find out what the gene mutation and you target that. The side effects are much less, and the survival, as I can show you, is much better. So this is a comparison of patients who have got EGFR mutation who has been given chemotherapy versus targeted therapy with a drug called gefitinib. Can anybody tell me what this curve is called? This type of diagram, what it is called? Okay, it's called a Kaplan-Meier survival curve. Essentially, whatever number of patients you take, here you can take a 96 and 98, you make them 100%, and then you follow them over a period, and you can see the patients, as and keep, here in that case, they progress. That means the disease has increased in size. You keep marking them whenever they progress. So we can say with by looking at it at, say at 300 days, that's about 1 year, most of the patients who are taken chemotherapy had the disease progression, while only about 50% who had taken the targeted therapy had disease progression. So one look at the chart can tell you a couple of other things, right? So this is called Kaplan-Meier curve. We use that a lot in cancer. Why do these, obviously it is the question is, if targeted therapy is so effective, how come people continue to progress? The disease keeps increasing over a period of time. Better than chemotherapy, but it still progress. So the reason is they develop something called resistance mutations. And one of the mutations is a major mutation called T790M. Anybody can explain what T790M means? Okay. When the proteins are lengthened out, you start numbering the amino acids from 1, 2, 3, 4 and so on and so forth. So obviously EGFR has got maybe 1000 odd amino acids. The amino acid at 790, normally it should have normally that amino acid should be threonine. But because of this point mutation, that particular base mutated, that threonine has been replaced with a methionine.
Right?
This
for the amino acid
or the base things also you can. But this we are, it's easier for us to remember the amino acid number. What happens is when this amino acid is different, it's mutated, normally these, I told you the proteins are folded in particular shapes and they form pockets in which the drug can go and sit. So normally, like for this example, gefitinib goes and sits in a pocket which is formed partly by threonine. But when this threonine is replaced by methionine, the pocket is not properly formed, the drug cannot sit. So the tumor becomes resistant. And of course there are multiple other mutations. So but major one is T. So if the cancer cells are smart, we are smarter. So we found a cell drug which can go and fit into that particular pocket. And so you can make out by this that if you TDM T790M positive, then the survival is very low rather than if it's negative. So we found this drug called, it's called osimertinib. What a funny trade name, osimertinib. And this particular graph is called a waterfall chart because it looks like a waterfall, right? So essentially it shows that when you give this drug osimertinib, each tumor reduces in size to a particular level depending on how much dose you're giving. There's multicolors for the doses. So I'd say 30% is when we say the patient has got a partial response. So you can see each of them are individual tumor samples. So many of them actually had a very good response. I think few of them actually went into a complete 100% reduction, so complete response, right, at 160 milligram dose. So cancers evolved, we also evolved as per trying to fool them, they try to fool us, we try to fool them. The second part, we talk about breast cancer. This is the breast cancer cell membrane. And on that there are four types of receptors called HER1 to HER4. It's got an extracellular domain, it's a transmembrane domain and an intracellular domain. In breast cancer, in fact many other cancers, HER2 is amplified and that's a dominant oncogene, it drives the breast cancer to a very aggressive type of breast cancer. A lot of patients die because of this as they get brain mets. So HER2 is the one which it is magnified in breast cancer and we need to block that. There are two ways of blocking it. You can block it from outside or you can block it from inside. How do you check for, again, what we described initially? We can check for this by immunohistochemistry. These are, I think, got a bit blurred. These are negative and this is strongly positive. We treat only the 3+ with particular drugs. Or we can test again like Burkitt's, you can test by FISH. There are a lot of those red signal shows HER2 is amplified, right? So this is, normally what we do is we send the tumor tissue for testing. If it is 3+, we can start the drugs. If it is 2+, we send for FISH and then they will tell us whether the gene is amplified or not. Which are the medicines which will work on HER2 amplified breast cancer? There are two types. I told you from outside we use monoclonal antibodies and from inside we call small molecules called tyrosine kinase inhibitors. So we have trastuzumab, T-DM1 and pertuzumab, and from small TKI we have lapatinib. And all of them are available with us. So for HER2 amplified breast cancer, we have actual drugs which specifically targets HER2. And it helps. If you just give chemotherapy, again this is a Kaplan-Meier curve, 100% patients followed over so many months. If you just give docetaxel, which is a chemotherapy drug, you can see the survival is like this. But if you add Herceptin to it, which targets HER2, then the survival improves. Average survival improves by about 8.4 months and that's a significant jump. Normal survival with chemotherapy addition is about 2 months or something like that, so that's a significant jump. Not only we can use Herceptin, we can add pertuzumab to Herceptin and further improve the survival, and we can also either also use the other drug T-DM1, which again improves the survival. So this, the red line is the patients who got T-DM1 was improved significantly. So knowing the mutation status is very important. And this is just the tip of the iceberg. There are maybe 20, 30 cancers for which we have found the mutations and for which there are literally hundreds of drugs available, and it's very difficult to keep that all in mind because some of them have got very complicated names. So anyway, this is just a sample, but there are hundreds of gene mutations for which we have hundreds of drugs. The ultimate aim of mutations, of knowing gene mutations, it would be to do a gene therapy. If the gene is deleted, replace the gene, or the gene is overactive, to cut it out, to suppress it. That would be the ultimate aim, and that is gene therapy. Unfortunately, it is not there. So we theoretically we can replace a missing gene with a viral vector. You put the gene into a virus and give it to the cell, and thus it goes to the nucleus, integrates and replaces the missing gene. Unfortunately, it doesn't, it is very difficult to do that. It basically the uptake, firstly the virus going and integrating into the correct place may not happen. It may go and integrate in the wrong place and cause more mutations and more cancer, and the uptake is, transfection rate is not very high. So it is still mostly theoretical, so it's not that possible. But we do use absence of particular genes to use some to do something called oncolytic virus gene therapy. So this is basically a virus which has got a particular, in this particular case, a p53. It cannot grow in normal cells. It can grow only in cancer cells which the particular gene is missing, and when it grows in, it will destroy that particular cell. Like, that's what viruses do, they grow into a cell and destroy it. So the one which is in clinical practice is a virus called ONYX015, and it encodes for the p53 gene, the TP53 gene. In a normal cell which has got an active p53, the virus cannot replicate, but when a cancer cell which does not have p53, the virus can replicate and destroy the cell. So this has been tried out and it's pretty useful. So this is a head and neck cancer patient. This is not our patient, they're all from the, we don't have that particular drug available. Head and neck cancer patient on whom we have, which the drug has been locally injected, and as you can see, there is very good response. And this is a patient with colon cancer. This is a CT scan of the liver. You can see all these blackish places are the mets, right? When you start giving it, there is some improvement, and by 13 months, you can see the contrast. The mets have almost completely disappeared. So these are anecdotal reports. They are not really standard of care. They are under trials, but hopefully the theory is strong. The hopefully it will come into practice. The more interesting and the more recent, which has created a lot of excitement, is a technology called CRISPR-Cas9. And this is useful in, right now, till now we are talking about replacing a missing gene. This is useful in cutting out an overactive gene. It's called genome editing. And the technology is something like this. So we have the DNA which has to be modified, which has got the abnormal sequence. So basically, it has got a, this CRISPR technology has got a guiding RNA which takes the, it's got a technology which cuts out the particular abnormal part and guides the donor DNA to that particular place and replaces it, right? So if you have abnormal gene, that can be cut out by this, and the normal gene can be replaced there. It can be done easily in human cells and even zebra fishes, but in human beings, not been tried yet. They have done it in mice. So this is a mice which has got a CRYGC mutation, and that causes cataracts. But using this CRISPR technology, they could cut out this particular gene and replace it, and the treated mice don't develop cataracts. So eventually the hope is there that human, it can be done at human beings, especially patients who have inherited single gene mutations. Maybe we can treat them with this technology and correct it. So a lot of excitement, headlines. So hopefully this is the technology of the future. Coming to the hereditary part of the talk, so essentially cancers can be of three types: sporadic, which is the usual one which anybody can get because of bad lifestyle and so on and so forth, and then there is familial and there is hereditary. The difference between familial and hereditary is not really clear in my head, but I'll try to explain it. Familial is when it occurs in a large number in a particular family. But unlike hereditary, you cannot find the genetic basis. I think this is the explanation. I hope I'm right. So there is a lot of families you will find that, you know, mother has got cancer, daughter has got cancer, aunt has got cancer. But when you test them for genes, particular genetic abnormality, you don't find it. We have in from Royal Hospital, we sent about 50 samples of patients we strongly felt had mutations, and I think only 4 or 5 of them actually had mutations. So it is familial, but it's not hereditary. It's partly because they think basically the same lifestyle, the same family will eat the same stuff, so they may get the cancers. Or maybe they're having genes which are of low mutations and not really known. So this is the essential difference between hereditary and familial. So if you take colorectal cancers, most of them are sporadic, garden variety. And 20%, there is some clustering in families, but only 5% of them are actually hereditary. You can find mutations called FAP, and there are two types of syndromes, large part of syndrome called Lynch and FAP. The major part, you cannot find a gene mutation. Just in the runs in the family, but nobody knows why it is there. And it's same for breast cancer also. A large part, we really don't know why the family, the breast cancer runs in the family. But we do know in some groups at least, BRCA1 and BRCA2 mutations are there. Same for prostate cancer. I think we'll skip that, we already. Right. There are a lot of genetic syndromes. Most of the people with gene mutations don't look normal. They look like you and me, and you really have to test the cells to find out the mutation. But many of them have what we call dysmorphic features, and they're called genetic syndromes. One look at them and you can say, okay, this person looks as if he's got this particular syndrome, which makes them susceptible to this particular cancer. And there's a whole lot of them. Dr. Nishat was telling me we have a lot of Beckwith-Wiedemann syndrome here in Oman. There are a lot of other syndromes like that. I'll just talk to you about Wilms tumor, which is the kidney tumor which comes in children. Now, Wilms tumor is associated with many syndromes, but essentially it's associated with Beckwith-Wiedemann. It's associated with a syndrome called WAGR, which stands for Wilms tumor and aridia, that means no pupils, genitourinary abnormality and mental retardation. Again, I'm told that mental retardation is not to be used. The correct term is intellectual disability, right? So these are the four syndromes, and they all present with dysmorphic features. Beckwith-Wiedemann has got features like exon fallos, macroglossia, and I'll show you a picture. These are not cases, this is actually Beckwith and Wiedemann, but they have a small head, microcephaly, creases. This creases you can find in a lot of people, so it's not part of Beckwith-Wiedemann. They have a very large tongue, macroglossia, and they have exon fallos. They have centrine abnormalities and genitourinary abnormalities. This is Beckwith-Wiedemann syndrome, and they are prone to Wilms tumor, which is a type of kidney tumor. Similarly, hereditary breast cancer, there are a lot of syndromes which can make them susceptible to breast cancer. Leaf Romani, Cowdens. Cowdens can be recognized. They have some certain facial features. Peutz Jeghers have got pigmentation in the tongue and in the lips, and a lot of other syndromes. But we'll be talking mainly about a little bit about Leaf Romani, and then the hereditary breast ovarian cancer syndromes. So Leaf Romani is obviously described by Lee and Romani. It is a very unusual cancer, a very rare cancer, but it can, because P53 is such an important gene, it can form tumors in multiple parts of the body. And here is the pedigree chart. The index had a bilateral breast cancer, but they also, the family had osteosarcoma, leukemia, brain tumors, soft tissue sarcomas. Because P53 is so essential, if it is mutated, it can cause cancers in any part of the body. Important to know this, it's rare, but important to know this, because if they put under surveillance, their survival is almost 100%. If you know which cancer to look for and catch them early, if you don't put them under surveillance, most of them will be dead by within about 5 to 6 years. It's very important to know this particular cancer. Coming to the bigger part of the topic, hereditary breast ovarian cancers. Anybody can identify this lady?
Angelina
Jolie, yes. You cannot discuss hereditary breast cancer without knowing Angelina Jolie. And the reason is this. Angelina Jolie's mother had breast cancer but died of ovarian cancer. Her grandmother had ovarian cancer and maternal uncle died of breast cancer. And this, I think, when she was young. So she got herself tested and found she had a BRCA1 mutation, which increased her risk of breast cancer by 87% and ovarian cancer by more than 50%. So what she did was, and it was a headline news in Time magazine, she had a bilateral mastectomy and replacement followed by also an oophorectomy. Which is, because she is in show business, it is a major thing for her to do. So in future, you will be the ones advising future Angelina Jolies. Do you need to go for mastectomy? Do you need to go for oophorectomy? These are very important decisions which you will be guiding us. Okay, if it's a normal breast cancer, the BRCA gene is there, the risk of a normal person is developing breast cancer is 1:10. But if you have BRCA2 mutated, that hikes it up to 4:10. And if BRCA1 mutated, it is 6/10. So that is almost 60%, actually it's even more, can get a breast cancer. They also can get ovarian cancer and other cancers. There are other genes also which are important. The ones which produce the highest risk, as we already described, BRCA1 and BRCA2, PTEN is another gene which causes Cowden syndrome and the TP53, which we have been discussed many times. There are another group which causes slightly smaller risk, about two times, PALB1, which has been described recently, ATM checkpoint. There are a lot of other genes which probably gives small amount of risk, which really needs to be, we don't test for them. BRCA1 causes breast cancer risk, second primary breast cancer on the opposite breast, as well as ovarian cancer, lesser risk of other cancers like pancreatic cancers. And BRCA2, not only breast cancer and ovarian cancer, but also prostate, stomach, melanoma and pancreatic cancers. It is really important to know which cancers this mutation can cause, because then you can advise the surveillance. If you know that a male patient has got BRCA2, then you have to make sure that he goes for checkups for prostate and prostate cancer, stomach cancer and so on and so forth. These cancers can be easily caught early and fully treated. I will not go into the testing guideline, they are a bit complicated, but essentially you test for persons. If you know a family member, then you test him. You got a personal history of early breast cancer, or personal history of ovarian cancer, or a male breast cancer, or any of the close family members meeting the above criteria. There are multiple criteria. I don't think it's possible to remember all that, so it's better to keep a chart next to you and go as per that. The advantages of testing are many, which sometimes patients don't like to know. First, of course, you know your own risk of developing cancer. You know the risk of passing on to your children. The more important thing, which I have told you earlier, is you can do preventive measures for other cancers and also for treatment purposes. So that's a carrot you can dangle in front of your patients. Look, if you know what mutation we have a specific treatment for you. That will motivate a lot of them to get the mutation testing done. There are disadvantages. One is, it's bad, psychologically you are in a bad shape. People can refuse employment, insurance rates will go up. Although legally it's not allowed, they can still do it. So there have got some downsides also. If you have a BRCA mutation, how do you screen? So for the breast, you do annual, you have to start early. Normally we say above the age of 40, but here we start at the age of 25. And because the young breast, which is difficult to do mammogram, we advise a breast MRI. We can do chemo prevention, that you use a drug called tamoxifen, which is an anti-hormonal agent. It reduces the risk, but it's still not standard of care. The other thing is like what Angelina Jolie did, was to undergo a risk-reducing mastectomy. For the ovarian part, we can remove the ovaries once the childbearing is over. We can use chemo prevention by oral contraceptive, and of course you screen every 6 months. This is a series from Netherlands, where patients who had one breast cancer, had BRCA mutations, they underwent a risk-reducing mastectomy. And you can see the risk of contralateral breast cancer. If you don't do that, 20% of them got it. If you do it, only 2% got it. So it is very effective. It's not only reduces the cancers, but also the risk of dying. By almost 50%, the risk of dying of breast cancer reduced, which is very significant. And this is the, again, Kaplan-Meier curve. Patients who underwent the mastectomy, they are 90% survival, while those who didn't, only 81% survival. So it's important. We can intervene, we can treat. The treatment can be specific for the mutation. This is a little complicated, but essentially DNA develop double-stranded breaks very frequently, which is healed by something called a PARP, an enzyme called PARP. But you need both the PARP as well as the BRCA to heal this this break. And if the BRCA is there, it is healed properly. But if BRCA is deficient and the PARP is inhibited, the cancer cell will die. So there is this is ovarian cancer in a BRCA mutant patient. You can see multiple nodules all over the abdomen. And these ovarian cancers, almost 20-25% of them can have a BRCA mutation, which can be inherited or it can be spontaneous also. So if you use this particular drug, olaparib, which inhibits PARP in BRCA deficient people, you can see the survival is much higher than not using the drug. So you can tell the patients, look, if you know have a BRCA mutation, you know you're higher risk for ovarian cancer, we can check for that. And if by bad luck you develop ovarian cancer and is metastatic, we have a particular drug which you can use for you. So it's very important to know what the mutation the patient has. Coming to colorectal cancers, like we said, 75-80% are sporadic. A lot of them are familial without known risk factors. The most important ones are FAP, familial adenomatous polyposis, and hereditary non-polyposis, which is also called Lynch syndrome. Lynch is much more common than FAP. Depending on general population, the risk, this is USA statistics, about 5%. But if you have HNPCC mutation, which is a Lynch syndrome mutation, the risk is 70 to 80%. Less common is FAP mutation, which is more than 95%. So this is less common but more aggressive mutation. So if you have a FAP, title is misleading. If you have a in the general population, as you age, the risk of colon cancer goes up, which is not very high, about 5%. But if you have FAP mutation, almost 100% of you will develop colon cancer. And this is the Lynch mutation, where again, the chance of getting colorectal cancer by age of 70 is up to 80%. So very high chance of getting colorectal. So what is the FAP syndrome occurs because of mutation in the APC gene. And depending on which part of the APC gene is affected, you can have three different types of syndromes. This is the classical FAP, where you do a colonoscopy, you will find multiple polyps, studded with polyps. And they also have risk of other tumors. This is the attenuated FAP. There is a FAP mutation at a different, APC mutation at a different segment. There are not many mutations, but there are not many polyps, but they can have UJ, that is upper gastrointestinal lesions also. The other mutation which I will talk about is Lynch mutations. Long time back, 1914, the person called Alfred Bovary, he thought there could be a genetic cause for cancer, and this was followed by a person called Aldred Worthen. His seamstress is the one who does the tailoring. Her family had lots of cancers in her family. And he started collecting that data, and this data was collected for over a century. And they found that every generation had developed multiple cancers, and finally it's a scientist called Lynch who discovered the mutation which caused this particular type of cancers. So the Lynch mutations occur in a group of genes called mismatch repair genes. It's not a single gene, but a group of genes called mismatch repair genes. As I told you earlier, the DNA repair genes repair the DNA mutations, and if the DNA repair doesn't work, the mutation can pile up and cause cancers. So there are multiple genes which cause, normally they repair mistakes, and they are mutant, it results in cancer. The children have a 50% chance of getting it, and if you have it, up to 85% risk of getting a cancer. The problem with Lynch is that most of them are not diagnosed. Only 5% are currently diagnosed. So there is a recommendation that anybody with colon cancer should be checked for Lynch syndrome. We are trying to get the material for this to test for Lynch syndrome. It's work in progress. I'm sorry? What are you doing? You're the MSI part or the immunohistochemistry? I'm sorry? You're doing that MSI testing. Okay, good. Because we are trying to get the immunohistochemistry facilities we have. So the Lynch cancers are mostly on the right side. There are also plenty of other cancers of endometrium, ovary, stomach, and so on and so forth. And if you have this particular mutations, the maximum risk is of colorectal cancer, but you can also get uterine cancer, get cancer of stomach, uterus, biliary tract, and ovary. So multiple cancer, you should know again the spectrum so that you can advise the patients accordingly. The genes involved are on chromosome 2, 3, and 7, MSH6, MSH2, PMS1, MLH1, and PMS2. They are all not equally bad. If you take all the Lynch syndromes, most of them are caused by MLH1 mutations. The second largest is caused by MSH2, and quite a few are unknown. But MLH1 and MSH2 are the main mutated genes in this. And depending on which is mutated, the type of cancers also differ. I will not go into the details of that. There is a criteria called, how do you diagnose this? There is a clinical criteria called Amsterdam criteria. And if it is positive, you send the patient for testing. Or if it's negative, you do another type of guideline called Bethesda guidelines. And then you test them by either MSI or IHC. I will not go into the details of that. The Amsterdam criteria and Bethesda criteria are not very sensitive. So that's why the recommendation is don't bother about these criteria. You just go ahead and test them. All colon cancers less than age of 60.
Two minutes.
Yeah, sure. You can test them for by immunohistochemistry. And if they are mutation carriers, you can have interventions. You can do colonoscopy, ultrasound, EGD, and so on, OGD, and so on and so forth. And patients on surveillance, they do very well compared to those without on surveillance. So they need to be on surveillance. And they can be treated with aspirin. You can see patients who are given placebo, they develop a lot of cancers, while patients who are not who were on aspirin, the number of cancers were as much as normal. And this is not important for you. The problem with having a mutation is, I don't know whether you recognize this, the story of Democles' sword. The Democles was the normal citizen who was wondering why the kings had such a great time. The king told him, okay, come and be in my place, enjoy all the life, but there will be a sword hanging on top of you all the time. You can get your head cut off anytime. So having a mutation is something like having a Democles' sword hanging over you. If you have a strong risk factor and then you advise the patients for gene mutation, most of them will say, don't do it. Some of them will say, oh, go ahead, it's routine, let's do it and finish off with it. It's your duty to counsel them that this will really help them in treatment also. You know the personal risk, risk of passing on, and how to manage. Unfortunately, nothing is 100%, so we can only say the risk is higher than normal. It saves a lot of people. If you screen and detect cancer early, they survive longer. And the take-home messages are, firstly, that cancer is a disease of genes. Any type of cancer, there is some gene involvement in it. And sequential gene mutations cause cancer. If you know which is the driver mutation, you can target it and cure, you cannot cure it, but definitely control the disease. In hereditary cancer, we should know so that we can, a lot of intervention to save lives. And of course, people like you are most important because we don't have time to sit and counsel patients what is their likelihood, what are the risks, which are the interventions, and so on and so forth. It not only helps the patient, it helps his family and the society at large. I think, thank you very much. Mm-hmm.